and I was just minding my business, right? Because I had a lot in my mind. I had to go back up to the headquarters. We had a lot of stuff going on. And this family, I knew was running late. This tourist family, they must have just come out of the airport and they had to catch the commuter flight, sure, to Maui or Kauai or whatever. But the husband had like three or four bags. I think the guys can relate to this. The wife had a baby and the two sons were in tow. Mm. And I was just watching them. They were running across to try to catch the Wiki Wiki bus. You ever been to Hawaii, you know what a Wiki Wiki bus?
Yeah.
Yeah. I stand there, I go, oh my gosh, I hope they catch their flight. And then they stopped right in front of me. They stopped right in front of me. The father puts down all his bags. The two boys were standing there right next to him. I didn't know what was going on. The father came up to me and shook my hand. Like you did, Ron. He shook my hand. And he said, sir, thank you for serving our country. Thank you for what you do for us. Honestly, James, that's what I go, oh my God.
Wow.
I mean, I was not expecting it. But that fellow American doing that to me, I mean, I would jump in front of a bullet for our country any day, any time, for those moments. I share that with you because that's where the American public and the American people look at us in uniform today. Mm. But to you, those that had to bear through a generation where it wasn't always like that, where the gratitude isn't always like that, where an army guy walks through an airport and people literally stand up and clap, mm-hmm. it's because you have set the road for us. So my third point to all of you, out of just pure humility, is to every day that I am in the Navy, every moment that I still stay in, I strive my best to make your generation proud. And I strive my best to hand over what I have learned from your generation to the next generation, like Frodo, and those that are still in high school.
Yeah.
I try to hand them over so that we continue to do what our country has always asked us, and we've never looked for any accolades or anything, which is to offer what many of our fellow Americans have, is the ability to have life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and not worry about somebody suppressing their thought or idea. Whatever our ideas are, they're beautiful ideas. Mm. And the fact that we all, in unison, serve our country, I will tell you what, you have my 100% commitment as to making me the best person I could be as an officer, as a leader, and as a sailor. The fourth thing I want to tell you is if you always think about an admiral, first you find a person who's very blessed. Because I'm not any smarter than any of you. I'm definitely not as good looking as some of you. But I will tell you this, I'm very blessed by the sailors and officers in chief that have served with me. Because they believed in working as a team.
Yeah.
And so any admiral or any captain or any whoever that says, oh, I did it because I did it, no. They totally missed the boat. Mm. I am here as a product of our Navy. I'm here as a product of my sailors working with me hand in hand and believing in me. So I stayed in this Navy. So I joined in 76, right, as an enlisted when I went to prep school. And I really didn't think I was going to stay in the Navy. I wasn't even thinking about joining the Navy when I was in Guam. So why did I stay for over 32 years of active duty? I'll tell you, there's only two reasons why I stayed, and I'll share it with you. And I share it with every young sailor who doesn't know what they don't know. Remember when you were 18? Oh my God. Phyllis, remember when you were 18? You don't know what you don't know, but then you acted as if you knew everything.
Yeah.
Right?
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. So when I was 18, it's like, there's no way I was gonna like stay away from Guam. I'll just try this out, it was an adventure. I stayed for two reasons and two reasons alone. Because I always found it wearing our country's cloth, especially growing up in Guam. And I think, James, you said you were stationed in Guam.
Yeah, 6970.
And if you know the history of Guam,
yeah.
Because Guam was handed over to the United States in 1898, right?
Yeah.
But Guam is one of those U.S. territories that was invaded by somebody else. And then Americans came back and took us.
Yeah.
And they saved us. And they gave us back our democracy and our liberty.
Yeah.
Our generations have never forgotten that.
I walked through the tank yard.
Amen.
The tank farm up on that mountain. Remember that? I grew up in that, sir.
Oh.
I grew up with my mother telling me what it felt because she was 18 years old when the Americans came back over Petey, Essen, and Agate. These were the landing areas.
Yeah.
And she told me how she was so elated when a GI gave her a Hershey bar.
Yeah.
Really, every time I look at a Hershey bar, I think of my mom.
Yeah.
And I think about the gratitude she had with the people and the Americans that were there. Fellow Americans coming back and giving us back our freedom. So when you think about one of the things that drives me to wear this, and I didn't even know about it. It was in my heart. I know it was all in your hearts. But when you're 18, you don't think about that flag-waving thing. But it's in our heart as Americans that we have this burning desire to, you know, give back to a country who's given us so much. So through the years, one of the things that drove me was that duty, honor, country. It's the honor of serving our country. And I told young sailors, hey, even if you serve as a Zone A, even if it's just for the first enlistment, it doesn't matter. You have put a pause in your life. You could have done anything else, but you're wearing our country's cloth. And nowadays, when you think about Afghanistan, when you think about the sailors and soldiers, sailors and marine, airmen and marines that lost their lives in Afghanistan and all of that, I think about the honor that they have given us to serve our country. For whatever reason it is, they served our country. So I stayed in a lot for that. I'll give you the one story about growing up in Guam, and it has to do with the Vietnam era.
Yeah.
Anderson Air Force Base, right? They
right.
launched the B-52s
yeah.
out
right.
of Guam into Vietnam. You remember that?
Yeah.
And I grew up in Guam because my dad's, you know, retired Navy. So I had a dependent's ID card. So we could go into Anderson. And I used to see those buffers all lined up. Loaded for bear. And as a kid, you know, my cognitive maturity was not there yet. But I used to see them all launch in pairs of three.
Shake everything.
Shaking. But they always launch in threes.
Yeah.
And then so many hours later, sometimes three come back. Sometimes two. Sometimes one. But that era, your era, really stood out with me because I was an altar boy. I'm a Catholic, sir. So I was serving as an altar server, and right there on a Saturday when we buried one of our young soldiers that died in Vietnam, guess what was draped over that coffin? It's our flag of our country. So as a young altar server standing there and seeing the sorrow and pain and anguish and the sacrifice the family has given, and the thing that was so vivid to me was our flag. And then I remember they would do the 21-gun salute, and then they will fold that flag so reverently, and then that presiding officer will present it to the surviving spouse or the mom.
Yep.
So I'm watching this. I mean, it's not just once. I see this a lot. And sure enough, what do they do with that flag? They hug it close to their heart, and they just nod their head, and there's silent tears. There is no why or whatever. They just clutch onto it and they say, I understand. And then, when I was at home watching Walter Cronkite on TV, so fast forward, you know, in between those moments, I saw on TV, now remember Guam is way out there, right? But back here, back in the mainland, you know, there was a lot of expression of I'm against the war, but they took it on our flag. So here I am, a young kid, watching the news, and they were burning the same flag, our flag, where we just buried one of our brothers from Guam. Some of them I knew. And I was so confused. Can you imagine a young kid? I was so confused. And I turned to my dad, who's a, you know, he was a World War II veteran. He's a Korean War veteran. And I said, Ta, that's Tata. I said, Ta, I don't understand why they are burning our flag. And you know what my dad said? I mean, this is the beauty of our country. My dad says, boy, don't worry about those people burning our flag. Just remember what that flag means to you. And you know what? He said, please don't pass judgment on other people. Just understand your values and where you were grounded, and the flag grounded me. It made me understand. So that's one of the big reasons why I stayed in. This duty, honor, country goes beyond time.
Absolutely.
You still wear it in your heart. You still bleed red, white, and blue. I bet you if I ask one of you guys to all stand up, and I'll swear you in, you all stand up.
Amen.
Right? Amen. Right? Can I do it?
I'm already standing.
Yes, sir. I can't do it, sir. There's an age limit. But anyway. The second reason why I've stayed in the Navy, because it is hard, and I've been married for 25 years. It is very hard to say goodbye to your family at sea, you know. The reason why I stay in, and it resonates, and I see it in your eyes. I see it in your eyes. It's the shipmate.
Yep.
It's the relationship you all built down in the engineering space or up on the flight deck. I stayed in because these great Americans, I don't care where you're from. I don't care if you're from Maine, Alaska, California, Texas, Wisconsin. No, I'm a Minnesota Vikings fan. And I don't like cheeseheads, but I give respect. No matter where they're at, I'll tell you what, they're cut of the same jib as you.
Yep.
Every one of you, they're cut of the same jib. And don't let any news or any article ever like convince you they're any different than you and I.
Yeah.
I mean, even nowadays, think about the millennial generation.
Yeah.
I mean, just go out there and look at them. They're so educated. They're so well informed. They're a little bit more worldly than when we were growing up. I mean, my God, when we were growing up, we didn't even have telephone answering machines. Right? We didn't have Facebook. We didn't have Google, where we can ask, hey, where's the capital of spam, the spam capital of the world? And we were Googling that tonight. That is the generation that mans the rails of our ships today. That flies our airplanes, that goes underneath the Arctic on a submarine that you don't know.
Mm-hmm.
They have that burning passion. They may not know it because we didn't know it as 18, but they still have it. They still have it.
Amen.
I was out in Hawaii op area about a month and a half ago. We were launching aircraft at night. The plane captain, you guys all know what a plane captain is.
Oh, yeah.
Normally the youngest up there on the deck, in charge of that whole team to get that aircraft so the pilot could launch safely. She did not realize that the F-18 that they were handling, instead of shutting the engines, they were actually lighting off one of the engines on the port side.
Oh, boy.
And she got too close. That plane captain, you can imagine what happened.
Yeah.
When they started up to 72% power, she got sucked into the engine.
Oh.
But this is not a bad story, because what happened was one of the yellow shirts standing right next to her as part of the team did not even hesitate. You know what he did? He just grabbed onto her with all his might.
Oh, man.
And saved her. So the CAG came up to me that night. You remember that, Frodo? He said, sir, something just happened tonight. And he explained it to me. And I said, how was that plane captain? She's all right, sir. The only thing she lost was her cranial. The helmet,
oh.
It got sucked in.
Oh,
she has her 10 fingers, 10 toes. Thanks to that handler, that ABH3. I went right between launch and recovery. I went up to the flight deck control. I wanted to go shake that man's hand, right? I wanted to give him a coin.
Yeah.
And I shook his hand, and the chief, of course, it's always a chief.
Yeah.
The chief said, Admiral, he's never gonna say this, but when it all happened, I wanted to take him off the line.
Mm.
And here's this young American. Really, I don't even think he shaved yet. Really, he was that young. And he was looking down, you know, he was nervous. He thought he was in trouble because I was up there. And he said, sir, ABH3, the first thing that came out of his mouth after that all happened was, how's my plane captain doing? How is my plane captain doing?
Mm.
And the chief goes, don't worry about the plane captain. She'll be all right. Well, we're going to take you off the line in this next cycle. right? Because anybody would be shaken up, right?
Yeah, yeah,
well,
yeah,
what do you think that ABS-3 said?
No way, sir.
No way, chief.
Oh, yeah.
No way.
I've got other pilots, and I got to take care of my team.
Yep.
That's the cut of the jib of the sailors today. That was the cut of the jib of the sailors then, when you were serving. Any different? Mm-hmm. Heck no. Heck no. Decades of years, but we all are bonded by that same type of work ethic, professionalism, everything. So I only ask you this, in the short time that I'm here to see you, please continue your relevance as an association.
Yeah.
Please continue to honor those that serve our country in the past, in the present, and in the future. Our country depends on it. If we are to move in the future and to be as vibrant as a democracy, we must have those that can stand up and defend our way of life. And there are many Americans out there that do. And when you do come across a sailor with a sea bag, wearing his cracker jacks, waiting to go home on leave, please do what that family did in the baggage claim. I know you all do. That one handshake will fill up their tanks.
Yeah.
It'll fill up their tanks. So, I was going to talk to you about the complexity of the 21st century operational dynamics that we have, but it's kind of getting late, and I don't want to get you guys to fall asleep. I wanted to go speak with all of you.
There you go.
That's cool. If you are interested, I can talk to you off the line about hybrid electric drives and electric magnetic pulse guns that don't fire around. And I can tell you all about biofuel.
Be proud.
I can tell you a lot about things we do, about a radar that can take the size of smaller than a tennis ball. I know I'm being recorded, so I can't say anything classified. But we have radars that can take a size of an object smaller than a tennis ball, and you can see it in a blink of an eye over 200 miles away.
Whoa.
I mean, we have systems that you can track exo-atmospheric, which is 100,000 feet up in space. Radars that can actually track a ballistic missile that's going incredibly, ridiculously fast. And to be able to bring a weapon up there to intercept it.
And then airplanes that can't be seen by that same equipment.
Yes, sir. And it is all manned by men and women of the same cut of the cloth that you all have.
Fascinating.
So, if there's anything your association can help, stress the value of science, technology, engineering, and math. We talk about the scholarship, sir, that you deal with, but we need to encourage our young men and women. They must challenge themselves in education. They must challenge themselves in the analytical rigor of tomorrow's challenges. Yesterday's challenges, today's challenges, pale in comparison to what these young men and women. When Frodo is a CAG, or when Frodo is a carrier skipper, whichever leg he chooses, they will have incredible challenges that you and I can't even imagine.
Yep.
If I tell you guys cyber warfare, you go, what is that, like Star Wars? No, it is so real today.
Yeah.
Cyber warfare is something that many adversaries know that could be our Achilles heel. Yeah. Think about your cell phones. Think about everything that you rely on that's electronic, that's part of 21st century. And you see it nowadays. You see the scammers?
Yeah.
That's cyber warfare from the generic side. When people penetrate into your thing, steal your social security number, steal your Visa card number, and do the fraud, well, think about the warfare side of it.
Yeah.
Think about what people can do in cyber war. So can you imagine the challenges these young men and women do? And if you think our planes are smaller in terms of radar cross-section, if you think our submarines are quieter because of the air-independent propulsion systems we have, we're not alone in that. If the technology is germane to us, the technology is germane to others. I mean, look at your cars.
Yeah.
Made in, fill in the blanks, you know?
There you go.
It's not just USA. So that's why, if I can only ask you all to remember this, if you do have exposure to the young generation, the ones that before joined the Navy, encourage them, in those areas, those four areas I talked about. So let's say they don't serve the military. They don't serve our country, the military. But they can serve me being an incredible oceanographic scientist that can help me find that diesel submarine that's in batteries, that's so quiet. But we got to do this. We got to encourage them. We got to inspire them. And so what you guys do day in and out, you do inspire us. You inspired me to leave my strike group up in Everett to come down here and say hi to you.
All right.
You've inspired me. So I really didn't want to talk too long tonight. I just wanted to thank all of you. You will always be in my thoughts and prayers. I will remember tonight with the smiles and the laughter and the sharing of just your kinship and your friendship amongst each other. That is relevant. In life, as we get older, there are things that are not important, and there are things that matter the most.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you guys get it. I think you understand it. So please don't ever, like, lose gas, run out of gas when you guys are trying to continue to get your reunions together or whatever. I'll try to help you when I can. Depends on what I'm doing, right? Mm-hmm. But I will be your spokesperson in any way you want me to. And I'll do my best to try to get Master Chief McIntyre, the Command Master Chief, who's a female, the most senior enlisted on USS Nimitz. She should be standing here instead of me. Or somebody else that's, you know, we have about 16% of our sailors that are women on the carrier. 16%. Over 400 of them are women. And you know what? They're doing great. They're doing fantastic. Why? It goes back to my theme to you. They're just like you and I. Just like you and I. So it's an honor wearing this hat. I'll be wearing that jacket when I play golf. And I always think of you guys. Thank you so much.
Here, here. Here, here.